Welcome to worship as we gather once again virtually from Vermont Lutheran Church here in Black Earth, Wisconsin, and we invite all of you to join with us each week, at least through the end of February. We'll be doing virtual worships. We'll get back together in person on March 6th. In the meantime, please join us here. I do have an announcement for this week, and that is that we'll be having our annual meeting on Sunday, February 6th. We will have the annual congregational meeting. It will begin at 10 a.m. and be via the Zoom protocol on the internet. If you'd like information about how to attend that meeting, you can see our church's website at www.vermontlutheran.org, or you could call the church office at area code 608-767-3312. We hope to have as many people from the congregation joining us as we can. So please do so, okay? Let's begin our worship service for this week. We begin with our call to worship. Jesus calls us into this house of worship. We come with open ears, minds, and hearts. We come with our shame. We leave with healing. And so let us confess our sins, hearing God's promise of forgiveness. We can confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful God, Jesus shows us all the ways that we fall short. He also provides a way out of the holes we dig ourselves into. Forgive us our sins and show us how to make better choices, be better friends, parents, kids, sponsored partners, and co-workers. Let Christ's light shine through us. For the sake of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Jesus does indeed forgive. Jesus cleanses us of our sin and recreates us in God's image. Receive the entire forgiveness of all your sins. Go and walk free of guilt, shame, and sin. You are made new. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And then let us pray together our prayer for this day. Light of the world, you sent Nicodemus by cover of night to learn from Jesus, and Jesus shone a light on the darkness many were living under. Shine your light on us so that we may be beacons for others. In Jesus' name, amen.
A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 3, beginning in the first verse. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews, and he came to Jesus by night, and he said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into a mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Very truly I tell you, no one can enter into the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, You must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be? And Jesus answered him, Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and we testify to that which we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate light and do not come into the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. Here ends our gospel reading for this week. I bring you grace and peace from God our Father. Amen. Last week, I mentioned that there were certain things that have to be taken into account when we're examining a scripture lesson to find out what the full meaning might be behind it. And this week is a prime example of what I meant by that. For this account is a story about Nicodemus coming to meet with Jesus in the dark hours of the night. He doesn't want the other Pharisees to know that he's there. But there's more to this clandestine story than meets the eye, isn't there? For instance, we might notice as we read through this Gospel of John that there's a thread that runs through these revealing stories of Jesus that we have read in the past few weeks. The first Epiphany story has Jesus being baptized by John in the Jordan River. The second story about Jesus commanding the servants to fill 6 water jars so that the party would have enough wine to drink for their bridal celebration. In next week's lesson, we're going to hear about a woman at a well. Do you hear something in common here? Water, right? To John, water was a very sacred thing. Of course, living in the desert area, that's bound to happen, but there was more to it for John. So what about this week? Getting back to the story about Nicodemus coming in the dark of the night. He's a Pharisee, remember, so he can't be seen cavorting with a scofflaw like Jesus, huh? He has his reputation to protect. And so Nicodemus and Jesus talk into the night, and we see by this future behavior, Jesus must have won Nicodemus over that night, because he treats him pretty favorably in the rest of John to come. But we're missing something here, aren't we? If we remember that these stories all include something in common, that they all talk about water, where is the story of water? Or where is the idea of water in John's story, huh? It's missing here. Or is it? You see, Jesus told Nicodemus, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished when I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Of course, this is as confusing as all get out to Nicodemus, but Jesus is talking about baptism here, isn't he? And if you remember back to your confirmation days, what is the earthly element that we use in the sacrament of holy baptism? Right, it's water. Now, Nicodemus, being rather narrowly focused, asks, "What? Can a person be born twice? Can a person climb back up into their mother's womb to be born again?" But Jesus isn't talking about physical birth here, is he? Jesus is talking about being baptized by the Holy Spirit. There are all sorts of references to water in speaking about birth. If you have ever witnessed a live birth, you know that water is a very important part of the birthing process. Even in school, we learn about biology and human reproduction. We are taught the role of the water sac surrounding the baby during the pregnancy. Water keeps the baby safe and protected, right? And we know that water is essential to life. A human being can't go more than a couple of days without water and survive. And so, again, as these people are living in desert kind of area, water was known to be a precious commodity. People, animals, plants, all depend on water to live. But what Jesus is telling Nicodemus is that water, although being necessary, is not all there is that we need to live. All the essentials that we need, among them, is the gift of the Spirit. Now, there are times when Paul asks people in the countryside if they have been baptized. A common response to him would be, well, we've been baptized with water. To which Paul says, I will baptize you with water, but also with the Spirit and in the name of Jesus Christ. Water is necessary to our outward selves, our physical bodies, huh? But it is the Spirit that washes away our sin. Of course, Jesus informs Nicodemus about other things like where this baptism and Spirit come from. For the most widely known of Bible verses, Jesus tells to Nicodemus here, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. God furnishes not only the water that we need for life, but also God bestows upon us such marvelous things such as forgiveness for the things that we've done that we weren't supposed to do. Huh? And God not only gives us water to wash in, but a baptism in that very same water, that with the Holy Spirit we might be purified inside and out and guaranteed life everlasting. And we remember that God gives us these things freely, without reservation, all wrapped up in eternal love. For remember, God so loved the world. Next week, we're going to travel with Jesus as he meets a very special woman at a very special well. And once again, water is involved. Let us pray. Overly generous God, you bless us with our daily needs and more. Fill us not only with earthly things, but imbue us with heavenly food and blessings as well. Fill our hearts as well as our stomachs with nourishment that only you can provide. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. May you go and find peace this week. Amen.
Faithfully now God's praise we sing. baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit, dead in the tomb with Christ our King, one with his rising, freed and forgiven. Thankfully now God's praise we sing. Baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit, marked with the sign of Christ our King, born of one Father, we are his children. Thankfully now God's praise we sing.
And let us continue by praying our prayers of the church. We pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. We bring our doubts, our questions, our confusion before you, O Lord, knowing that nothing is foolish or unworthy of your time. Give us faith to trust your counsel and to learn from the messengers which you have sent through the ages. God of wisdom, hear our prayer. We are indeed faithfully and wonderfully made, along with your whole creation. Open our eyes to the wonders of this world, and humble us to be taught by all of nature, that we might learn respect and responsibility. God of wisdom, hear our prayer. So often the darkness suits us better than the light. When we hide in the shame of our memories, our shortcomings, our misdeeds. Bring us into the open, where forgiveness is real and redemption is the cleansing our soul's desires. God of wisdom, hear our prayer. Give us daily chances to be reborn in you. Bless our lives and our loved ones with your healing presence, especially those whom we name before you in our hearts and prayers, and those who struggle with the COVID virus and other difficulties of loneliness and impatience at this time. God of wisdom, hear our prayer. We are by no means the first to question, to wonder, to misunderstand. Generations have done so before us and have found their peace in you. Join us with all the saints of every age in your eternal communion where light shines perpetually. God of wisdom, hear our prayer. Hear our prayers, O Lord, and make of us the very answers we seek, light to the world and hope for your people. Amen. This week I have a little litany that I would like us to share together. Begins like this. Have you ever sneaked out under cover of darkness and hope against all hope that you would not be caught? That is the story of our friend Nicodemus, who travels in the dark to meet Jesus. He is willing to take a chance to see Jesus. He wants to learn truth from him. And Jesus does not disappoint. But the truth he speaks is difficult to understand. You must be born again. And Nicodemus rightly asks, I must re-enter my mother's womb? Nicodemus doesn't get it, and Jesus knows. Jesus is a patient teacher. At one point, Jesus gives us the heart of the gospel, the core of it all. For God so loved the world. And God did not come to condemn the world, but to save it. All of it. All of us. That's a lot to process. Nicodemus needed time, just as we need time today. A man of learning, a Pharisee, a man of wisdom. He was struck silent in the presence of Jesus, in the presence of God. It is all so hard to understand. Sometimes we feel like we're in the dark, yet God is there with us, there in the darkness. Patiently waiting, patiently answering our questions, promising us eternity, eternity for the entire world. Let us be like Nicodemus. Let us reach out in the darkness for the light of our Lord. Let us listen. Let us learn. Let us hold on to the summary of the whole gospel. God sent God's Son, Jesus, to us and for us, that we, all of us, may have life eternal. Amen. We pray together our prayer of offering as we offer ourselves to our Lord. We bring our offerings to you, not in the covering of darkness, but by exposing the light of day. Shine a light on these gifts and use them to serve those whose darkness is oppressive. For the sake of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. As we close out our service this week, I'd like to leave you on a higher note of sorts. I found a YouTube video that had what they call a Minnesota doxology, and so let us end with that this week.
Praise God, from whom all blizzards flow. Praise Him at 35 below. Praise Him in snowdrifts 10 feet deep. Praise Him though winter makes us weep. It's really cold.
Thank you for worshiping with us at Vermont Lutheran Church this week. Again, if you'd like more information, you can see us or visit our website at vermontlutheran.org on the internet. Hope to see you next week. God's peace.